Dear all, today I'm going to discuss with you the investigation. Already I've given you some idea about some of the inflammatory markers, but today we'll discuss the investigation in COVID-19. And we'll be following by the treatment of COVID-19. My focus will be on why those inflammatory markers we check, what changes we see in the X-ray, what changes we see in the CT scan, what are exactly it means, and naturally the last focus will be on the management of treatment of COVID, and I will give you some idea about post-COVID management. Dear students, you may come across the patients who get deteriorated after the completion of the treatment, so-called completion of the treatment. Because as you know that the procoagulants are upregulated and anticoagulants are down-regulated. High chances of thrombosis remains there, and that thrombosis may take place in the later period. And that leads to stroke, that leads to acute myocardial infarction, and such many things. And that's why end of the treatment of COVID is not actually the end, but preventive measures should continue for a few days later on. This is an important thing, every student should note it. My dear student, we will take a brief look first what we have already seen, because when I want to discuss the drugs, I will require that. Am I right? Now, I'm not going to make the picture of whole thing, but will be concise. This is the mimocyte. This is that EC2 receptor, and this is the virus. The virus enters inside by having a phagosome and protein available on its surface, puts the hydrogen ion in, makes the medium acidic, and disintegrated capsid. This integrates the capsid. All of you know this thing now. Now, I'm making this a little bit more big. The RNA gets separated. This RNA with the help of ribosomes will produce protein required by the virus, and there are copies of this RNA by using RNA dependent RNA polymerase. Now the proteins required for the virus are being produced by one way. In another way, the RNA is being produced. Now proteins are available, RNA is available. It will form new virus. This is what we call copy of the virus. They are enormous, very high quantity. And this is how this is mimocyte type 2 will burst. When this mimocyte will burst, the phospholipids of this cell will give you inflammatory chemicals. Phospholipids will give you inflammatory chemicals, and inflammatory chemicals are going to stimulate the macrophage. To be precise, alveolar macrophage. This alveolar macrophage is going to secrete interleukin 1, interleukin 6, and TNF. These are the inflammatory chemicals released by this alveolar macrophage. And thereafter, further, it is going to produce vasodilation. It is going to produce vasodilation and increase capillary permeability. It is going to produce vasodilation and increase capillary permeability. What does it will give you? When the vessels are dilated at a local place, I'm talking about the local place. The vessels are dilated at a local place, it will first give you interstitial edema. Followed by alveolar edema. Interstitial edema in the lungs and alveolar edema will lead to breathlessness, reduced capacity of breathing. Naturally, after some time, it will give you acidosis. Again, stimulation of respiration, and so many complications will develop out of it. These interleukins may give you fever by stimulating the brain center of temperature regulating center, TRC. Local synthesis of PGs will increase, prostaglandin E2 will increase, and it will give you fever. Local inflammatory things will give you breathlessness as well as cough. This is in short what happens. In short, I have given you the idea because I want to tell you the drug today. Before going into detail of it, as I told you, it is all related with the pneumocyte. Dear student, do remember my words. Not only the pneumocyte is the tropism of the virus. Other tropisms are also there. Even already I told you, the olfactory cells of nasal mucosa, then the test buds, pharynx, these are also the tropism. It also includes GIT. It also includes gastrointestinal tract. Gastrointestinal tract is also having tropism. And that's why diarrhea, nausea, vomiting may be the signs of this COVID-19. In this epidemic, it is better to suspect and better to analyze each and every patient who is having either the respiratory symptoms, either the GIT symptoms. If you are suspecting, you should go for testing. This is a basic thing every student should follow. Now, just I told you the tropism, the whole story in short, because I want to tell you the drug, where the drug is going to act. I will make the arrow on it and you will be happy to understand it from me. Let us see what exactly happens. Wait. When you are suspecting the patient and patient is not willing to undergo the test, yes, there are patients, they say that, doctor, it is just the common cold. I don't want to go for the test. At least in that case, you should isolate the patient. At least you should isolate the patient, because that will save other family members from COVID, one. Second, if an old age person is there inside in the family, he is having some comorbidities, then the risk significantly increases. And that's why you should put, you should give the advice to at least check. Checking is really important so far this suspected COVID cases are. Second thing, symptomatic patients are also there. Suppose in a family, you are getting one person affected, his test is positive. Then it's mandatory for other family members to undergo the test. You may ask me why. Because the student, there is a high possibility that those patients also get infected. Those persons also get infected. Then you may ask me, Dr. Joshi, they don't have any symptom. Why to ask them to go for the test? The answer is very simple. Those persons may not have symptoms but get infected. We call them asymptomatic patients, or they may be just carriers. Then you may ask me, what is the caution? The caution is very simple. Isolate them if they are positive. And that is why, my dear student, in a very early stage of this pandemic, government people created huge places, tambu, where they just go and put the patient who are asymptomatic. Then you may ask me, what is the role of that asymptomatic? Asymptomatic himself is not having the problem, but he can spread. And the spread is a major issue. Already I told you, G0. Spread rate is very high in case of 1:3. One person affects 3%. In case of influenza, it is 1.3. Spread, one should stop. And to stop that spread, the basic thing required is isolation. Full care, isolation. And that's why if a person in a family get affected, the test is positive, he's having the symptoms, other family members should also undergo the testing. Though they are having the symptoms or though they are not having the symptoms, very important point. Because they may not have the symptom but can spread. G0 is very high. Spread of corona is very high. And that is the reason why one should test other family members of an infected person. This is an important point for general practitioner. My dear students, in our country, the most important person, healthcare professional, is a general practitioner. First point of medical contact is maximum time to the general practitioner. And that's why I always used to say that he must be empowered. General practitioner must be empowered. Because actually he is the person providing the healthcare facilities to maximum population. And that's why he must be empowered. He should be empowered. Chain breaking is the main thing. Well, this is what I'm talking about, these asymptomatic carriers or asymptomatic patients. Now, yes, in the last lecture, after completing the lecture, one of the students asked me, sir, please talk on the risk factors or the comorbidities. Now, I will be talking about the comorbidities. There are studies available with the comorbidities. And you'll be surprised to know from me that the dangerous thing, the most dangerous factor is the age, above the age of 60, 70 and 80. There is a sharp rise, I'm repeating, there's a sharp rise in the death ratio of the persons who are above 60, 70 and 80, and the risk increases at about by 14%. Do remember, age is the most important contributory factor. Age is the most important contributory factor, and the risk increases by 14%. So far, the age of 60, 70 and 80 is concerned, higher is the age, more is the risk. It suddenly increases after the age of 50. After the age of 50, it suddenly increases. Everyone should note this point, 60, 70 and 80. Second important point, you will not believe, is not diabetes. It's not diabetes. It's a cardiovascular disease. Cardiovascular diseases approximately increases, that is by 10%. Second important risk factor. Second important risk factor in COVID next to age is cardiovascular diseases. All IHD, CCF, all cardiovascular. Then the third comorbidity, which is risky, is diabetes. And in this diabetes, please note my point, high HbA1c and controlled diabetes, the person who is on insulin and still his sugar is not being controlled properly, HbA1c is constantly above 8, are at the highest risk. And the calculated risk of diabetes by multiple studies ranging in between about 6.5%. CVD is 10%. Age above 60 is 14%. I'm going to repeat. Risk factor, age is the most important risk factor. Second is cardiovascular disease, CVD, cardiovascular diseases. And the third is diabetes. Now, if you go in detail of it, the fourth risk factor, the fourth risk factor is the person who is on immunosuppressive medicine. The person who is on immunosuppressive medicine, either the patient of transplant or the patient of cancer, who is on chemotherapy, because all of you know that many of the chemotherapeutic agents are immunosuppressive, especially they are suppressive for the bone marrow. WBC count decreases and patient becomes susceptible. Am I right? Yes. If you calculate this risk is about 5.5%. This risk is about 5.5%. Highest risk is with age, followed by cardiovascular diseases. Third important is diabetes, and four is immunosuppressive medication. Age is the most important thing, and it suddenly rises after the age of 60. Up to 60, it is fairly less. If the patient is below 60, but is having diabetes, then risk is there. Is having immunosuppressive medication going on, risk is there. That increases. So this is the thing, my dear student, I want to share with you, that the highest risk is with age. Above the age of 60 is a greater risk. You may see all these things with the patients around you, and that's recorded. Also, my dear students, you like my explanation regarding this comorbidities and risk factors. Now, I'm going to discuss with you the test. I have a very less area to discuss. Again, yes, I can erase this thing. I'm not going to erase the remaining part because all of you know that that is important for me to discuss the drug, because pathology is important, tropism is important, and how we are going to break it is important. Now, test the very important test, a very simple test is rapid antigen test. Rapid antigen test. What do you mean by this rapid antigen test? Rapid antigen test detects S protein. Already we have discussed this S protein in the very first lecture. This is the protein against which body produces antibodies. It's an important part of the virus. Body produces antibody against this S protein. Dear student, do remember my words. We want to detect this S protein. Kit is there. Kit is loaded with the antibodies. Try to understand. My sentence is very important. The kit. The slide is having antibodies. You put the material over here, blood over here, or the secretion over here. The kit is having antibodies. Your sample is having this antigen. Your sample is having antigen. I'm not talking about the antibodies produced by the body. No, I'm not talking about those antibodies. I'm talking about the antibodies of this S protein. Those are loaded on this testing kit. Antibodies are in the testing kit. You are putting the sample containing S protein. If reaction happens, then the test will become positive and you will say that a sample contains S protein. That's why I'm using the word rapid antigen test. What we are detecting? We are detecting S protein. We are not detecting antibodies against this S protein. This is the test where the results will be available within just 1 hour. It is by the FDA, but in India, you can say that within 4 hours. 4 or 5 hours, you will get the result. Practically, it is difficult for our overall infrastructure, which is available to us, within 1 hour. You may get it within 1 hour, but 4 hours is a better thing you should consider. Try to understand, in this antigen test, we are not going to see the antibodies. No. We are going to check whether that sample contains S protein or not. Sample contains S protein or not. If the sample contains S protein, it's simple that it contains the virus. And actually, you need not to go for RT-PCR thereafter. Actually. But generally, what we do, we answer. Why? That is the point. Generally, even after this test, we go for RT-PCR. Still. You may ask me, Dr. Joshi, already you are tested S protein is present, ultimately virus is present, why are you going for RT-PCR then? My dear student, false negative. False negative test is a major issue. False negative test is a major issue. And that's why even the test is positive or negative, we still go for RT. When a positive, you should not go actually. But if it is negative, still one should go for RT-PCR, because false negative test percentage may be about 51. Test is having this issue always. The antigen is new, everything is new, and that's why false positive, false negative is a major issue. And that's why you should go for the antigen test. If it is positive, actually you need not to go for RT-PCR, actually. But it is better to go for, because as false negative is there, false positive also. And that's why combination of antigen test with this RT-PCR, both of them taken together, would be a better option. And that's why in India, in our country, in our population, though we go for the antigen test, if the patient is having symptoms, we'll prefer to go with RT-PCR. Now, you may ask me, Dr. Joshi, please tell us, what is this RT-PCR? What is this RT-PCR? Now, I'm going to explain this. I think this antigen test is clear to everybody. Now, I'm going to tell you about RT-PCR. RT-PCR stands for real time reverse real time polymerase chain reaction. Real time. It is not reverse transcriptase. People say anything. This is wrong. It is not reverse transcriptase polymerase chain reaction. No. It is real-time polymerase chain reaction. Why? Why I'm using the word? It is the fragment of that RNA, that is a viral RNA, fragment of that RNA that we put, and then we put primers, enzymes, especially TEC polymerase. Primers mean, what do you mean by primers? That nucleotides are known as primers. Adenine, guanine, thymine, and thiamine and uracil. Those are the primers. The primers we put some enzymes, we put TEC polymerase in it, in the chain, and we replicate it. Millions of copies we produce. And if that copy matches with the copy of original copy of the virus, then we said that the test is positive. In very simple language, we take the sample, we isolate its mRNA, fragment of it is being multiplied by using the primer enzyme and TEC polymerase. Multiplication has to be checked with the original. Are they going to match or not? If it is positive, then we say the RT-PCR is positive. In very simple language, if you ask me what you check, we check RNA actually. And that's why it is having highest reliability. You practically check whether that particular RNA is present there or not. And that's why if you ask me, Dr. Joshi, what is the most reliable test of this coronavirus? The answer is very simple, my dear students. RT-PCR is the important test. Most important test, most reliable test. We are not checking the antigen. We are not checking the antibodies. Then you ask me, what you're checking, Dr. Joshi? I am checking direct virus. And not only virus, I am checking its RNA. Whether that RNA is present or not, that is what I am checking. And that's why this RT-PCR test is the most reliable test of this virus. Hope so. You got the exact point what I'm going to say. Hope so you like the explanation. It is important to remember that the test may be again false positive, false negative is also here also. Now, the possibility of RT-PCR false negative is even 30%. Roundabout. See, I should be clear to you, there are many kits available in the market. testing and validation of the kit has to be done by ICMR, but not 100% reliability is there, because it is all statistics based today. And that's why, do remember my words, not always the test is correct. Then with the different kits it is different, but still the possibility remains 30% of false negative. What does it mean, false negative? It means that a patient is having the disease, but the test is negative. Yeah. And that's why if such a issue is there, then you have to go for HRC. I'm going to tell you the idea about it. Antigen test, I told you. RT-PCR, I told you. Now, we'll be talking about HRCT. Now, my sentence is very important. Very important. Your patient is having the symptoms. Your RT-PCR is negative. And you are going to tell the relatives that the test is negative. But still you are suspecting. Because the symptoms of the patient are suggesting you he is having anosmia. He is having loss of test. But the test is negative. Then you may think, this may be a case of false negative. All red lights are on. All red lights are on. Oh, something risky is that. Test is negative, but patient is having the symptoms. Then the best idea to go is HRCT. What is this HRCT? High resolution computerized tomography. High resolution computerized tomography. What does it mean? It means CT scan of the chest. Now, I must make you clear, there is a difference between the US and India. By the government guideline, in US, HRCT positive patient is a positive patient, is a patient level as COVID-19. In US, just with the HRCT, his RT-PCR is negative. But his HRCT is positive. Then we label the patient with COVID-19. You may ask me, sir, why? Because they feel that. In India, by the government guidelines, HRCT is not a diagnostic. You can call it only suspected. When you take that HRCT positive patient as a positive patient of COVID, the number rises. Significantly number rises. In India, only diagnostic test that we allow to say confirmed diagnosis of COVID-19 is RT-PCR. When you take only one criteria to define, the answer is very simple. The number of cases will be less. Am I right? Now, why government of India is telling you that HRCT we will not consider? It is because of the fact that HRCT of other types of pneumonias, other complications of chest will also show that ground glass opacity. I'm going to explain you what is that ground glass opacity and what is the difference between that ground glass opacity and regular consolidation. That is what we define in pneumonia. I'm going to explain. But before that, I must make you clear that by the government guidelines, HRCT alone cannot be considered as the COVID positive patient. But clinically, the physician consider it and treat it. In practical sense, they are following US guidelines, practical sense. But so far, government guidelines are concerned. the person cannot be considered as a patient of COVID-19 only on HRT. He must have RT-PCR positive. In very simple language, we consider RT-PCR as a prime test, not HRCT. But US government allows even HRCT positive patient to be labeled as COVID-19 patient. This is a difference every student should know. Hope so, dear students, you like the explanations given by me, and I should further proceed with HRCT. Now, my sentences are very important, very important, very important. The shadow, very important sentence is passing now. The shadow of the lung on the x-ray is blackish. Every student will agree with me. Reduction in this blackiness and making it gray, or you can say hazy. Reduction in the blackishness, making it grayish, is known as ground glass opacity, popularly known as GGO. Very important point I'm going to make now is vascular marking. And even the non-vascular marking, that is the bronchioles, markings of the bronchus and the bronchioles, are not affected. I'm repeating, are not affected by in this ground glass facet. I'm repeating the whole sentence. I will show you some pictures. The shadow of the lung in a normal x-ray is blackish. I'm telling you in a very simple way. The reduction in this blackishness, you may ask me, sir, why there is reduction in this blackishness? Because interstitial edema, collapsing of the airways, less surfactant. Already I told you about in pathology, surfactant, pneumocytes, told you. That collapse, that collection of the fluid leads to reduction in this blackishness. You may ask me, sir, why there is blackishness? Blackishness indicates that it's a porous film. X-rays can pass through it and can make the film blacker. If the substance in between is an opaque substance, is a radio opaque substance, greater is the opacity, more is the whitishness. It means, very simply, if a substance is porous, X-rays can easily pass through the radiolucent, then it produces blackish film. But when the substance is lesser lucent, means more opaque, do not allow the X-rays to pass because the density is high. Then the blackishness reduces. In very simple language, the development of that interstitial edema, which is seen in 66% of the cases, that is increase in the density of that tissue. That increased density will reduce the blackishness, making it whitish, little whitish, means grayish. That is known as ground glass opacity. But when you are seeing that opacity, the bronchiolar markings and the markings of the blood vessels are not much affected. When the bronchiolar markings and the vascular markings are not much affected, then one should use the word ground glass opacity. Then you may ask me, Dr. Joshi, when they are affected, what word we should use? Consolidation. If you go to that, fluid is here, just beginning. You may call it ground glass opacity, collapsed. But when the collection is here also, full, these markings are not seen. blood vessels are also not sin. Only this thing is sin, then it is consolidation. Pneumonia is to be diagnosed by consolidation. But when the fluid is here, it has collapsed due to the loss of surface time, then it may give you the picture of GGO, that is granular superficies. This is a very important thing. Second important thing I must tell you about this GGO. I will show you some pictures. I must tell you something about these GGOs. I should show you the picture first and then we'll talk about it. My dear students, just 2 minutes, wait for 2 minutes. I have to arrange that. Just 2 minutes. Sharing. I am sharing one PPT. Please follow my cursor when I will ask you to follow it. Ground wall opacity means haziness in the lung tissue where the vascular and the bronchial markings are maintained. In consolidation, the bronchial markings and the vascular markings are not maintained and make it more dense. Typically seen in pneumonia, you can say more properly, the community acquired pneumonia. Hope so you are getting the thing. Now, the next slide is coming and it is a very important slide. Now, follow my cursor. This is the marking. This is the blood vessel. This may be the bronchus. And this is what I am trying to tell you about the ground glass opacity. Ground glass opacity is the reduction in the blackishness of the area, making it little opaque, more opaque. Radiolucency of the lung has reduced. This is one thing. This is what you can say ground glass opacity. But my dear student, if you go to the second image, this is the corresponding image, the adjacent image, consolidation, the word is written there. And you can see that neither bronchial nor the blood vessels are visible. And as compared to this blackishness, this is completely whitish. As compared to this blackishness, where repeatedly I am telling you there is reduction in the blackishness, it is becoming whitish. But still can show you the bronchial markings as well as the vascular markings. Then we call it, initially we call it ground glass opacity. But when the infiltration of the fluid, of the pneumocytes, of the WBCs, of the macrophages, all have occurred there, collected there, just like fluid is collected, then the density of that fluid is very high, making the lung tissue more opaque. And when it happens, we'll call it consolidation. This is a typical consolidation, and this is the ground glass opacity. My dear students, I think you understood what I mean to say. I'm making it simplified. Not all my words are correct, I know, but to understand is at this point of time for a student, whatever I said is correct. Am I right? Then I'm going to show you the next slide and we'll compare that slide with the next slide. Let us see. This is the slide. My dear student, if you see this area typically, this blackishness is highest here, but has reduced in this area. But still, you can mark the vascular and non-vascular components. You can mark it. But if you have put the next slide, here you cannot mark. You cannot mark the vascular and the non-vascular marking. Here you can. Here you can see the mesh work. Follow my cursor, please. Follow my cursor, please. You can see the marking, but in the next, you can't. You can't see here. This is typical consolidation. And if you ask me, what is this, Dr. Joshi? I will say, dear student, this is likely to be a ground glass of ulcer. An important point. Hope so you understood what I mean to say. Here markings can be visible. Here markings are not visible. If you compare it with the scan, here is again, you can see the minimum opacity is over here. And here, complete opacity. Are you getting my point? This is typically ground glass opacity. Hope so. You understood what exactly I meant to say, how it is the relation with the interstitial edema and the related things. In India, HRCT is not a final diagnostic tool. It is just the tool to suspect. Am I right? HRCT alone is not considered a diagnostic, complete diagnostic for us. I'm going to stop the sharing and we'll talk to you with the next topic. Hope so all of you like my explanations regarding this point, and let us see. I told you the difference between the consolidation and the ground glass opacity. Hopefully you understood it, and I'm going to tell you the next thing. The next thing is that, I should tell you that also. Score. Score is a not so difficult issue. All of you know the right lung is having 3 lobes and the left is having 2 lobes. And that's why if you talk to me about the lobes, 2 plus 3 is equal to 5 lobes. Clear? When in a lobe, very important, in a lobe, the percentage, very important, of affected part is in between 1 to 5. So getting my point? The lung, lobe, complete lobe. In that one lobe, percentage is affected. Suppose this is a lobe. Suppose this is a lobe. And this much percentage is affected. Then I may say it is just 5%. Then you have to give one mark. When it is between 5 to 25%, then you have to give 2 marks, points. 25 to 50%, then you have to give 3. 50 to 75, you have to give 4. And above 75, you have to give 5. It means that if the whole part is affected like this, almost like this, you can see the ground glass opacity in the whole lobe, then you have to give 5 marks. Suppose I'm getting this thing, considering it, say, above 50%. But less than 75%, then I may give 4 marks. In very simple language, we are having 5 lobes, and maximum marks can be given 5. 5 into 5, maximum score is 25. Now, one important point is here again. It will give you the area affected. But very clearly telling you not the severity. It will give suggest you, okay, this lung part is affected. It is not going to give severity. Already I told you ground block of already is just the beginning. Even vascular and non-vascular markings are well maintained. Not well maintained, but are maintained. Ground glass opacity. When the ground glass opacity in one lung tissue, one lung lobe, affecting only 5%, below 5%, you have to give 1 mark. In between 5 to 25%, 2 marks. In between 25 to 50%, 3 marks. 50 to 75%, 4 marks. Above 75%, it is 5 marks. The maximum score is 25. Am I right? Now, 1 to 9 score. 1 to 9 score. One should use the word mild. 9 to 18. Some people take it even 15, and some people take it 18. You should call it moderate. And more than 18 should be called as severe. Other score is also there, I should tell you. Other score is also there that makes 20 parts of the lung, and the score given is either 0, 1, 50%, 2, more than 50%, that is 100%. And 20 areas are defined of the lung. That is how it might be multiplied by 1, 20. Or it might be 20 multiplied by 2, max 40. And that's why in somewhere you may get 40 out of score, and somewhere you may get 25 out of score. Actually, if you practically think, this 25 out of score is very easy to understand and to conclude. And that's why I'm going to tell you about this 25 score only. Hope so. You like the given explanation regarding this lung, effects of the lung and the CT scan. Consolidation I talked to you about. HRCT, ground glass opacity, bilateral, unilateral, already told you about. 5 areas are given. Marking is how the marks are to be given. I think I have covered these all points. Now, whether your patient is maintaining O2 saturation or not is more important than this mild, severe, or the moderate ones. Whether your patient is really maintaining the oxygen saturation. Now, you may ask me, Dr. Joshi, what is that? That is very simple, my dear student. The cutoff value is 24%, 94%, 24%. It is 94%. If it is below 94%, then yes, he is not maintaining his O2 saturation. AHA, American Heart Association, also gives you this cutoff value. If the patient is having below 94, then it should be considered a patient is breathless and you need to give that oxygen to the patient. 94% is the cutoff value. More important is this cutoff value, whether your patient is maintaining his oxygen saturation or not, without giving any aid, any help. When he's maintaining, it's okay. He's not maintaining, then you have to start the steroids and so many things I will tell you later on. Just you now remember this 94% is a cutoff value. O2 saturation of the patient is a major criteria. Breathlessness is a major criteria to define whether to give the medicines, whether to start the steroids, whether to start the LMWH or not. O2 saturation I told you about. I'm missing something. I'm not getting. Very, very important. This HRCT finding. Are more pronounced in second week of infection. This is a very important point. In early stages, you may not get the HR30, but in the second one, yes. Second week is more important than first week. One thing I must tell you, my dear student, very important point I'm telling you. You may get a patient having breathlessness and no fever. You may get a patient with breathlessness and all other complications and no fever. This is what I'm saying since a long time, that the damage due to virus may be small, but the damage to the activation of our own immune system may be high. It may not be related to the direct viral effect, but may be related to the activation of our own immune system. This is a point every student should know. And that's why major complication always takes place in COVID in second week. The first 7 days are likely to be sick. Likely, not always, but likely to be sick. Major complication always takes place in between 7 to 10 days or 12 days. Those are most dangerous days. And may prolong, that is common thing. This is a very important point. This happens, HRCT and all these major complications takes place in second week. Major complications takes place in COVID in second week. They may not be related to the direct viral load. It may not be related to the direct viral load. Hope so, my dear students, you understand what exactly I mean to say in this lecture, in this point. Hope so. All of you are happy too. And that's getting the details about that HRCT, ground glass opacity, consolidation, details of HRCT. High HRCT score. Breathlessness, OP is not being maintained. Very, very dangerous. O2 saturation is low. And HRCT score is high. This combination indicates that you should start remdesivir. IV injection, steroids should be started. I am going to go in detail. When I will discuss that, first we will discuss the investigation. Hope so you are getting it. I think it's okay. Now, I should tell you one very important investigation, and that is on the hemogram. What is the finding in the hemogram? Do you remember my words, finding in the hemogram? Common finding in the hemogram is lymphopenia. Yes, lymphocytes are going to reduce and neutrophils are going to increase. May thrombocytopenia. Thrombocytopenia, neutrophils are going to rise, lymphopenia is going to develop. This is the picture, typical COVID picture. And one more parameter I should tell you that indicates the severity, that is the ratio of lymphocytes to neutrophils, LN ratio. If this ratio is greater than 3 or 3.5, the case is considered as a severe case. Again, need not to tell you about this, all things. It again happened in the second week. In the second week, when the lymphocytes are reducing, neutrophils are well maintained or increased, they are increased, and lymphocytes are so reduced and neutrophils are so increased, the ratio of them, if it is greater than 3 or 3.5, then the case is considered to be a serious case. initially, when you go for the CBC, you will get lymphopenia as an indicator of a viral infection, as well as you will get thrombocytopenia initially. And that's why you are seeing the X-ray, the patient is having the symptoms, you send the COVID test of RT-PCR, and all you are doing, and you are having hemogram. That hemogram can also suggest you this important lymphopenia with neutrophils and the imbalance between them up to the difference of 3 times. That is what I am using the word ratio. Neutrophil and lymphocyte neutrophil ratio greater than 3, 1s to 3 or 3.5 is likely to be a serious case. The case is likely to be a serious case. This is the importance, this is a very important point regarding the CBC. Also, you like my explanation. Second important thing I must make you clear here also, here only, and that is ESR. ESR is always raised in such cases. Erythrocyte sedimentation rate, it indicates any infection. Here, COVID is also raised. This is non-specific parameter, but yes, it is raised. It's a non-specific parameter because it raises in every infection. And that's why we will call it a non-specific indicator. But still, yes, as we are talking about hemogram, ESR, we should talk about the ESR also. Thrombocytopenia, lymphopenia are the two important things. Everyone should note this point. Which in this typically observed in the second week. Second week is more dangerous than the first week, repeatedly telling you the same thing. Lymphopenia and thrombocytopenia, these are seen in the first week also. These are early changes. And all other remaining changes, this week, NL ratio, LN ratio, these are the second week findings. Hope so, dear students, I told you about all these things and you must be happy with it. Yesterday, last lecture, we had discussed about the LFTs and RFTs. I may not go in detail of them now. I will talk to you later when we'll go in the inflammatory markers, results of the inflammatory markers. Let us see the next thing. Chest X-ray already I have shown you. Now, now I should tell you some important things about whether I'm not getting, we have discussed this ERP or not. ERP, this is stand for C reactive protein. All of you know that IL-6, pyruvate one is IL-6. Liver also secretes IL-6. Liver also secretes IL-6. As an inflammatory marker. This IL-6 and even TNF-alpha, IL-6 and TNF-alpha, where these are the parameters. These are the lymphocytes is going to give this inflammatory markers, the cytokines. Those are secreted by this activated alveolar macrophages. They are activated due to the inflammatory chemicals released by the dead cells. One of them is interleukin-6, TNF-alpha. Those are going to stimulate the product, stimulate the liver. And liver is going to produce CRP. CRP, C-reactive protein. This is acute phase reactant, more common word. It is more reliable indicator of infection-induced inflammation inside the body. Infection-induced inflammation in the body is indicated by this C-reactive protein. Lysophosphatidyl kinase, I think, choline. Lysophosphatidyl choline is a molecule, very important, is expressed on the dying cells, dying or dead cells. I'm going to repeat. Lysophosphatidylcholine is a molecule expressed on the dead cells of the dying cells, pneumocyte and all that. This molecule is having affinity for this C-reactive protein. The sentence is important. Lysophosphatidylcholine is a molecule present on the dead cells or the dying cells. C-reactive protein attaches to it. And the combination initiates complement response. Then you may ask me, what is this complement response? It's a chain of protein present in the blood. No need to go in detail of it, but the end result is important. Activation of the complement system gives you MAC. Membrane attack complex. What is this membrane attack complex? Yes, they are also known by the name perforins. When this MAC is activated, it perforates the cell. Drilling sarka kaam hai. It drills the cell and kills the cell. Drills the cell. The drilling of the cell is activation of the complement and drilling of the cell. MAC is there. Membrane attack complex is there. It is going to kill the cell. This is how C-reactive protein is involved in killing of the dead cell. In one way. This C-reactive protein is important. Perforins are there. And this is the role of this C-reactive protein and its exact function, what happens with it. Am I right? Yes. Normal value should not exceed 6 milligram per day. Actual normal value is, we need to discuss it. It is, I think, 50 micrograms to 5,000 micrograms like that. Not to go in detail of it. Today you should remember that it should not be. The value should not be greater than 6 milligram per day. If it is more than that, then you should consider that, yes, CRP is rising. CRP is rising. CRP indicates inflammation, infection induced inflammation. If you go in detail of it, you may find that the raised value in between 10 to 40 milligram per day. Per DL or per liter? Per liter, I'm sorry. Per liter. Is indicative of a viral infection at a very raised value of about 40 to 2200 milligram per liter is indicative of some bacterial infection. I think one should not go in detail of it. You just remember, it should not be crossing 6 milligram. If it is crossing 6 milligram, then it is right. We are talking typically of the COVID. One should not go in details of the inflammatory markers much, because it will be already it's a long lecture. Third lecture I'm taking, and still I'm long way to go. Yeah, everyone will be happy in this after this lecture, series of lectures. Hope so you are getting that C-reactive protein. Now, the second important thing that one should note is D-dimer. What is that? D-dimer. What is that D-dimer? D-dimer, it's a D protein. It is fibrin split product. When the fibrin is to be degraded, then it produces this D protein, and two D protein attaches to each other, and that's why the word is dimer. They are attaching to each other. Fibrin degradation product, split degradation product. Fibrin degradation product will give D protein, K dimer. This value is important. 500 nanogram per ml. Per dm is the normal value. When it is more than double of its normal value, then it should be considered risky. Actually, if you go into literature, much opinion difference is there. The literature says somewhere that it should increase by 4 times to increase the possibility of having complications of COVID. But generally, the value of 1,000, more than 1,000 nanogram per dl, is considered as a raised value or a negative indicator of this for D-dimer. D-dimer value should be less than 1,000. If it is greater than 1,000, very simple, you have to start LMWH. Clexane. You know that Clexane injection? 0.4 milligram should be started once daily for 7 days at least. Hope so. You like my explanation? D-dimer value is a major indicator of starting LMW. Hope so. All students are getting. This is the D-dimer issue. I'm going to close the issue now. Now, D-dimer we have completed. Ferritin, already I told you about ferritin. Ferritin is a transporter of iron actually, but it rises in cancer. Yes. It rises in inflammation. Yes. It's acute phase reactant. Yes. The value is 300 microgram per ml. Am I right? Per liter. When the value is above 600 microgram per liter, then it is said to be raised. The normal value is around 300 micrograms per liter. One thing one student should note, that ferritin value reduces in pseudomonal infection. I'm repeating. In pseudomonal infection, the value actually reduces. In pseudomonal infection, but in all other bacterial and viral infection, the value rises. Ferritin is the acute phase reactant. Every student should note 300 microgram is the value. Now, LDH. Lactate dehydrogenase is the enzyme. It indicates tissue injury. And in our case of COVID, it is hypoxic injury. The cells are being dead because oxygen is not being supplied because of the less perfusion to the organs. Why there is less perfusion to the organs? Because of the capillary dilation. The fluid has reduced from the blood. When the fluid has reduced from the blood, the hematocrit of the blood will rise. The blood returning towards the heart reduces pumping by the heart, reduces perfusion to the tissue reduces. And when perfusion to the tissue reduces, everyone will agree with me that a hypoxic condition will be produced. When hypoxia is there, the cells will be dead. And when cells will be dead, there is rise in the LDH value. Normal LDH value is 230 to 460 international units per dm. This is an important point every student should note. LDH value should be less than 460 or 450. You can take 460 is okay. Am I right?
Yes.
Now, one thing I should tell you about this. Cardiovascular involvement, very important topic I'm going to tell you. CPK-MB and troponin. Cardiac troponin, CTNT and CTNI. Cardiac troponin T and cardiac troponin I, both. If are raised, it indicates it is related to the very high mortality of the individual. It indicates that the myocardium is injured. And when myocardium is injured, everyone will agree with me that the mortality will be high. And that's why, while checking all these values, what value we have seen? We have seen ESR, then we have seen C-reactive protein, then we have seen ferritin, then we have seen LDH. Am I right?
Yes.
Then we have seen D-dimer. While seeing all these things, one should see all these things. That is, CPK-MB also should be done. Troponin, CTNT, CTNI should be done. And if found raised, then yes, the case is a dangerous case because myocardium is also involved in this COVID issue. When cardiovascular disease is already present, then prevents the possibility of rising of the CPK-MB and troponin, CTNT and CTNI. Hope so, dear students, you like the explanations given by me. And also the morbidity, comorbidity, and all those things we have discussed. Do remember, very simple, when the patient becomes breathless, patient must be admitted. Very simple. Don't keep the patient at home when the patient is becoming breathless. For a general practitioner, this is the bottom line. He should and must admit the patient when the patient is becoming breathless. Patient may require oxygen supply. Patient may require ventilation. Patient may require other supports. There is no place to continue the treatment at home when the patient is already breathless. Very common thing. And that's why you should not treat the patient when, I'm going to give the guidelines for general practitioners. So I have derived it from government guidelines only. All what I'm telling you is related with the government documents and maybe our government or US government, but it is related with the government documentation. Many guidelines are studied and extract. I made an extract of it. And that is what I'm telling you. Hope so, dear students, you like my explanation. When the patient is breathless, it is better to admit the patient. Rather, it is better to admit the patient immediately. Am I right? It is important to note that a patient deteriorates in the second week of the infection. Many times I told you, second week is more important. After 7 days is more important. Complications of hypoxia, hypercoagulability, then cytokine storm are related in the second week of the infection. Many IL-6 one has to see in that case. Already I make a comment that fever is not an indicator of the complication. I'm very much clear about my words. You may get a patient breathless, complicated, having no fever. Patient may be recovered from his fever and started complication in the second week. In first week, may have fever, high grade fever, all that complication gone patient becoming breathless, he's having cough. Patient is having cough, patient is breathless, not having fever, you should be cautious. This is related with your immune system. Virus has initiated what it wants to, and now you are facing the complications of your own immune system. And that's why already I told you, early introduction of steroid is really important, because that can control the activation of our own immune system and can protect our own tissue. In the last lecture, I discussed about the steroids. In short, I have discussed, but I have discussed. Am I right? Age above the age of 60, diabetes, cardiovascular diseases, patient on immunosuppressive medication are the major issues to be thought about and major risk factors. These are the major risk factors. Now, when to start the steroids? When the patient is not able to maintain the oxygen saturation, he is having raised the CRP value, then it is better to start the steroids. Then you may ask me, what steroid should you start? You are having option to use both the steroids. Mostly methylprednisolone should be preferred, because methylprednisolone do not interact with remdesivir. Dexamethasone should not be used with remdesivir. I'm repeating, dexamethasone should be avoided with remdesivir. You should use prednisolone. Prednisolone, the dose is regular dose, 0.5 to 1 milligram per kg. If you ask me, Dr. Joshi, what is this? Don't remember all these things. I'm telling you very simply. Either use 10 milligrams TDX or 20 milligrams TDX, depending upon the condition of the patient. It should be given for 5 to 7 days, maybe extended to 10 days. If you are going to for 10 days, then better to taper and then stop. Getting this point, or option is that you can use dexamethasone. Or you can use dexamethasone. General dose of dexamethasone is 8 milligrams OD or BD, depending upon the situation of the patient. 8 milligrams, one vial is there. Some people recommend 6 milligrams also. So far our practice is concerned, we generally use 8 milligrams, that is the whole vial. 4 milligrams per ml is the vial, per ml, S2ml vial is there. Let's say 8 milligrams is a better option or whatever. Depending on the situation, you may use it OD or BD. You are also having the option to use the inhalation steroids, that budesonide can also be used. But better to use the IV drug, that is going to spread all over the body. When the drug is being spread all over the body, the cytokine storm, which is a part of the body, will get controlled. When you are using the inhalation steroids, they are going to act locally. They are also useful, but they will going to act locally. When you are using the drug by IV route or by oral route, it is better that the drug will be acting all over the body and can control that cytokine storm. And that is very important thing for all of us. This is the use of the steroid. Try to avoid dexa, provide that methylprednisolone or prednisolone. Methylprednisolone is also okay. Prednisolone is also okay. I already told you about D-dimer. When D-dimer is raised, you have to use the LMWH. Flexon is very famous, 0.4 milligrams. Subcutaneous route once a day for 7 days, preferably. 5 to 7 days, or 7 days is a better option. Post-COVID management, I will tell you after the whole treatment. But right now, I think I should complete these points only. You can start assessing the patient earlier when he is not maintaining his saturation, one point. Second important point, when he is not maintaining the saturation, second important point, D-dimer is raised. It's better to start the anticoagulant, LMWH. Aspirin is not actually anticoagulant, it is antiplatelet drug. I will explain in the end what is the difference between that aspirin and what is that LMWH and the related drug, that is the indirect thermal inhibitors and all that. At the end, I will talk to you. Now, one very important thing I'm going to talk to you is tocilizumab. Tocilizumab is a drug to be used when the IL-6 values are high. It's a monoclonal antibody. IL-6 you have to block by using tocilizumab. Tocilizumab is a drug that you have to use when the IL-6 values are high. What is high? Normal value is 16 picogram per ml. It should be raised more than 10 times to start this tocilizumab. What is the role of tocilizumab here? It can stop that vasodilation, increase vascular permeability and all that. Complications leading to that multi-organ failure can be minimized by blocking this point. And that is the role of tocilizumab. It's a blocker of IL-6. Here you are going to block it. Am I right? We're going to discuss the drug in a short period of time. We're going to discuss the drug. Already I told you about. The testing of antibody and antibody generation and all those things I will be discussing so in the next lecture. Before that, I have to tell you the basics of immunity. Without understanding those immunity basics, you will not understand antibody production. And without understanding antibody production, you will not understand what exactly the vaccines are going to do. I think that the next lecture, which I'm going to arrange in the next Sunday, might be the last lecture of this series. And the most important lecture. Next lecture will be the most important lecture. Let us talk to you about the drug used by, I will be concentrating naturally on the general practice, but we'll give some idea about this thing also. The person who is not having comorbidity, the person who is not having comorbidity, not having a comorbid person at the home, maintaining his O2 saturation, can be treated by general practitioner. Means a person having comorbidity should not be treated. Comorbidity is person at the home, isolation not possible at the home should not be treated. A breathless patient should not be treated. A patient who is not maintaining oxygen saturation above 94 should not be treated at all. When the oxygen saturation is dropping, it is always better to admit the patient. Patient may require multiple help that is not possible to be given at home. And it is not the area of general practitioner to cover that. It is always better to admit the patient. Am I right? A symptomatic patient can be treated at home. Patient maintaining oxygen saturation, just having fever and related things can be treated at home. Patient having pharyngitis, anosmia, loss of taste can be treated at home, but should not have breathlessness. That is a very important thing. He should not have any comorbidity. A comorbid person should not be at home, and at the home, especially the toilet, bathroom should be separate. Isolation should be maintained at home. If it is possible to maintain, then only then the patient should be treated at home. Otherwise, patient should either be shifted to the isolation wards if it is asymptomatic, or to the hospital where the facility for oxygenation are at least available. These are very, very important points every candidate, every student should note. Overconfidence in treating the patient is of no value so far COVID is concerned. And that's why when you know that this is not my patient, you should shift the patient, you should refer the patient. All right? Wow. Now, my dear student, I should tell you something important. The drugs which I'm going to tell you about, antibacterials, are not to have secondary bacterial infection. I'm using them. I'm advising them. I mean the multiple guidelines. Azithromycin or amoxicillin plus clavulanic acid. You can use cefixime, or if you ask me, I will ask to go with doxycycline. Rather, I will prefer to go with doxycycline. You may ask me, Doctor, doxycycline is old around all DI students. Doxycycline also reduces IL-6 values. Studies are available. And that's why if you ask me, Dr. Joshi, what you are going to prefer, I am going to prefer doxycycline. One can use azithromycin, one can use amoxicillin, clavulanic acid is also good. Some people prefer cefixime, some people prefer doxycycline. If you ask me personally, I will prefer to go with doxycycline because I know that it is going to reduce IL values also, IL-6 values also. Now, all this is the point, this is the point to be considered for not to have secondary bacterial infection. They have nothing to do with COVID. Clear. Nothing to do with COVID. Clear? Yes. Now, these are the important drugs. Now, you can add chloroquine. You can add chloroquine. Now you may ask me, sir, chloroquine is having some issues? Yes. The role of chloroquine is controversial. You may first ask me, sir, what is the role of chloroquine? What is that? This hydrogen ion should enter. And here, inside that capsid, what is going to develop? Acidic medium. What is going to develop there? Acidic medium. This acidic medium can be converted to alkaline medium by using of chloroquine. Chloroquine is alkaline drug. When it enters the capsid, it do not allow the disintegration of that capsid. Viral RNA will not come out. And whole process, further process can be blocked. This is the idea behind using chloroquine phosphate. It's an alkaline drug, enters the virus and do not allow the disintegration of capsid. If the capsid is not being disintegrated, then there is no question of having anything else. This is the idea how on the preventive basis you can use this chloroquine phosphate. And initially, people say that, yes, it can, it has saved the life. See, there are many conspiracies, many pros and cons and many fighting issues are there. But if you want to use chloroquine, the dose is 400 milligrams BD for first and 200 milligram BD for next 4-5 days. Am I right?
Yes.
Clear? Four days. 5 days. One thing I must tell you, it must not be combined with azithromycin. Because azithromycin is known to prolong QT interval. Chloroquine is also known to prolong QT interval. And that's why if you combine them, you will get serious arrhythmia. What you are going to get? Serious Then you may ask me, Dr. Joshi, can I combine this chloroquine with amoxicillin? Okay. Can you combine with cefixime? Okay. Can you combine chloroquine with doxycycline? Okay. If you don't want to use chloroquine, you are not satisfied with chloroquine research, whatever you see, then drop the idea of using chloroquine. Where chloroquine was using, where we are preferring chloroquine to block this virus, then you are having another drug to block the virus, and that is ivermectin. Ivermectin, you may ask me, Dr. Joshi, what is the role of this ivermectin? Very important. When this RNA is isolated, it has to be transferred to this endoplasmic reticulum. Because ribosomes are there inside endoplasmic reticulum. The transfer of the RNA which is develop, which is there due to the dissolution of the capsid. Capsule get dissolved. This RNA gets separated. It has to be carried to this endoplasmic reticulum, means this ribosome. The carrier involved in the carrying of RNA from this capsid, dissolved capsid, to the ribosome, that is endoplasmic reticulum. That protein is called as importin. Importin is a protein which is involved in the carrying of the RNA of the virus, which is isolated from the capsid, to the endoplasmic reticulum, that is the ribosome. This carrier is important, and ivermectin blocks importin. Ivermectin block this importin. 8 milligram OD for 3 days is the dose of ivermectin. Most commonly, combination of ivermectin and doxycycline is preferred. You are having the option to use chloroquine that is going to act here, alkaline medium. You are having the option, if you don't want to use chloroquine, then you are having the option of using ivermectin. Ivermectin generally preferred to be given with coxcycline. If you don't want, you can give it with cefixime, you can give it amoxicillin acid, you can give it azithromycin. There is no problem. But do remember, the second drug, first chloroquine is going to block the acidic medium. The second drug, ivermectin, is going to block the transport of RNA. You are getting, they all are antivirals. They are acting on the viruses. The first line of drugs which are written there, first not line of drugs, the first drugs which are written there, they are antibacterial. They are meant for not your secondary bacterial infection. The second drugs which are suggesting, that is chloroquine, ivermectin, those are acting on this virus. Am I right, my dear students? Are you getting my point? Now, favipiravir is a drug. The third drug I'm going to tell you is favipiravir. Favipiravir on the day first is 3600 and on the day second it is 1800. The favipiravir tablet, Faviflu, is available in 200 as well as 400 milligram strength. If you are using this 200 milligram strength, this is divided. Divided means 1800 plus 1800 and 1600 is left. It is 800 plus 800 BD. Start with 9 tablets BD. 9 tablets in morning, 9 tablets available. It is 1800 and 1800. 9 tablets. Then 4 tablets and 4 tablets. Getting it? Yes. Now on the day first, total treatment is of 7 days. And that's why we are favipiravir. This is the drug I am talking about. You have to use 9 tablets for the flu. And for this, you have to use 4 tablets. This is for 6 days. And this is for 1 day, first day. First day and 6 day. Favipiravir. Now you may ask me, Dr. Joshi, can I use this favipiravir with azithromycin? Yes. Can you use it with amoxicillin glycinate acid? Yes. Can you use it with cefixime? Yes. Can you use it with doxycycline? Yes. Either use favipiravir or use ivermectin or use chloroquine. Don't use all of them. I'm making it very clear. These four, only one of them. These drugs, only one of them. Not all. Combination, I'm telling you. Getting my point? Because these drugs are having prevention for bacterial infection. These drugs are acting on virus. Yes. And when the patient is seriously ill, instead of favipiravir, we will prefer to do it remdesivir. Patient is admitted, then instead of giving favipiravir, we prefer to go at home. And remdesivir, IV drug, will prefer to go with in ICU unit. Now, one thing I should tell you. Favipiravir should not be used in the patients of gout. It is well known to increase uric acid level. Favipiravir is not to be used in gout. It increases the uric acid level. And that's why if you ask me, a patient of gout is there, I will ask you to go with ivermectin or chloroquine. People are not preferring chloroquine. Chloroquine means, hydroxychloroquine. Not chloroquine, hydroxychloroquine. Getting my point? Don't use it in gout. And favipiravir cannot be used in pregnant lady. Pregnancy you cannot use. In gout you cannot use. Then you may ask me, sir, when she is pregnant, what should I use? You should use this drug, where it is chloroquine. Chloroquine is entirely safe during pregnancy. It is well known. It is safe during pregnancy. Chloroquine, hydroxychloroquine, both are safe. Studies available. Multiple studies are available. You can use it. And this is how you have to define which combination you prefer. Am I right? Now, my dear student, when you admit the patient, then you have to change your strategy. IV drug has to be given, and that's why I will prefer to go with the next drug. Where is that? Now, I'm going to start remdesivir. This is again the same type of drug. Favipiravir, where it is going to use? Work? Yeah. DNA dependent RNA polymerase, it is going to block. Which one? Favi. As well as remdesivir. Both of them are going to block. Either use favipiravir or use remdesivir. Remdesivir, first dose 200 milligram. Second dose 100 milligram for next 4 days. Am I right? 4 days, 100 milligram, first day, 200 milligram. It has to be diluted in at least 100 ml and should be given for not less than half an hour. Preferably more than 1 hour longer. Slow IV is expected. Not fast. Slow IV, dilution 100 ml should be get taka. NS. 100 ml NS, add it there. Continue. Am I right? steroids are going to work here, all of you know. I told you where ivermectin is going to work, where hydroxychloroquine is going to work, where ivermectin, where favipiravir is going to work, where remdesivir is going to work. Told you the whole story. Am I right? Where that tocilizumab is going to work, already discussed with. Also, remdesivir is having certain contraindications. When remdesivir you want to use, there are certain contraindications. GFR should be greater than, should not be less than 30 ml per minute. Transaminases of the liver should not raise, breastfeeding, pregnancy are contraindications. Am I right? INR should be within limit. These are the indications of remdesivir. Drug interactions, already I told you, dexamethasone should not be combined with remdesivir. And remdesivir should not be combined with hydroxychloroquine. Do remember my words? It should not be combined with remdesivir, should not be combined with hydroxychloroquine, it should not be combined with dexamethasone. It should not be used when liver enzymes are raised, it should not be in pregnancy, it should not be used in breastfeeding lady. It should not be used in a renal failure patient where the creatinine clearance is below 30 ml per minute. These are the major things every student should understand. Remdesivir, the first dose is 200, second dose is 100, up to next 4-5 days we give 4 days. Total 5 days treatment is off, 6 days treatment is there. It should be diluted in 100 ml of NS. Should be given not less than half an hour. Generally, we prefer to give it for 1 hour. 1 hour more than that. Am I right, my dear student?
Yes.
Major indication of the steroid use, very earlier I told you, when the patient is becoming breathlessness, not maintaining his O2 saturation, immediately start the steroids. Patient on NIV, non-invasive ventilation. Patient on invasive ventilation, they should start IV. Methylprednisolone can also be given by IV route, or you can use this dexamethasone. If you're not planning to use remdesivir, then only then you can use dexamethasone. That very clearly I told you. Preferably we use the, generally we use the steroid for 5 to 7 days, but in this case it is better to give for 10 days. Then save the patient. Now the next and the most important thing, but a short point I'm going to tell you. I think I should make it clear now. Next topic is, should we give aspirin or should we give some drug that is like thrombin inhibitor, direct thrombin inhibitor to the patient? I'm repeating my words. After completing the treatment for next 1 month, we are planning to give either anticoagulant or antiplatelet drug. This is a very important comment. With the multiple studies, it is well established that anticoagulants are very effective in venous thrombosis. And antiplatelets are very effective in arterial thrombosis. When you are suspecting something wrong with the arteries, then you should use antiplatelet drugs like aspirin or anticoagulants. If you are planning for some venous thrombosis that should not happen, then you should use drugs like warfarin. Now, instead of warfarin, many people are preferring direct thrombin inhibitors. Like dabigatran. Dabigatran is a direct thrombin inhibitor. You may ask me, sir, what is the thrombin? All of you know prothrombin has to be converted to thrombin. Thrombin act on fibrin, act on fibrinogen to give you fibrin, and fibrin produces clots. Fibrin plus platelets is equal to clot. When you are using antiplatelet drug, it will act here. Antiplatelet, do not allow the platelet to aggregate. It will act here. And when I am using direct thrombin inhibitor, my drug is going to act here. My drug is going to act here. Dabigatran is going to act here. With the multiple studies, now it is well established that it is better to use anticoagulants than antiplatelet drugs. And that's why many people today are using this dabigatran. The dose is 110 milligram. Capsule is available. 110 milligram capsule is available. Efavirenz is available by some company. The company name is Torrent. Efavirenz, you can use it. 110 milligram OD. For how many days? 1 month. Standard regime today is of 1 month. This is post-COVID management, dabigatran. If you ask me, sir, I want to use aspirin, I may say yes, but better to go with that dabigatran. So this is all about the treatment part of this COVID. This is, the whole lecture was only for the information purpose. You are students, you are not expected to use it. And it is not for the common person. It is just for the students who should know it. And when they are using the drug in the patient, when they are working in the hospital, they should know why they are using it. This lecture, the whole lecture is not for the treatment purpose. This is a disclaimer by me. Am I right?
Yes.
This is for information purposes. Thank you, dear students, for being with me for such a long time of 2 hours, about 2 hours. Hope so you like my lecture. Expecting your comments on our group. Next lecture is very important. First, I will give you the whole best idea of the immune system, that is most important. And then I will tell you how these RNA vaccines, DNA vaccines, what exactly they are doing and why some people are afraid of it. Why some rumors are there in the market. We'll be discussing it, and that will be the last lecture. Like today, as you have given me good support of 2 hours, I may require 2 hours for the next lecture also, or may not require. I'm not having some idea. But do remember, very important thing, please comment on the group. You can comment personally also. Thank you for being with me. It takes good amount of time to develop a lecture, dear student. Good efforts are involved in it. I'm thinking whether you like it or not, and that is very important. Feedback is very important for the next lecture. We'll see you in the next Sunday by 4 p.m. to center. Thank you.